Or go open ob.gg's for all of them so we can talk about people's...
That's a good point, actually, yeah.
That's User disconnected from your channel. Well, we know... We know, most of
Praetorians.
Yeah, I'll get the other guys. I feel like the more op.gg has fixed, like, made their website look better, the worse it's actually gotten.
Yeah, I feel you.
You want to make a post on Irish League?
You want?
Sounds like a lot of work, though.
That it is.
So that guy's name is just Bram. That's pretty cool. Why is the default Korean?
Not a clue. Not a clue. What time is this game scheduled to start at?
Noon, I'd assume. Probably early. 9. Would make sense.
Yeah, let's say so.
Joined your chat. Type it in chat whenever you're ready, okay?
Is there the stream up?
Yeah, stream's up.
Yeah, we're ready. Disconnected from your channel.
We're good to go whenever we need to go.
Ryan, I think you should post that your thing, because...
I don't know if it's up or not.
Yeah, but it's... You want banter in the chat. Then again, it might be an interesting experience for us, just to talk about a game live. We gotta keep talking, basically. Nerd. Alright, I have all their names up.
Fantastic.
Are they in order?
Yes. Yes, they are.
So like, Rory the Fish is the top laner and all that?
I don't know about Narnia, but Praetorian are in order, definitely.
Microphone muted. Microphone activated.
Alright, it looks wrong here. Alright, sadly I can't tell who some, they all have really weird champion pools like Sejuani and Leona and stuff, so.
That's fine. I guess we'll see when we get into game. Like, we're sitting in Division 3, so I'd say a lot of the game will just be, you know,
okay,
picks
yeah.
And generally non meta plays. And picks.
Yeah, no, that's fine, they are in order. It's just like, for instance, this guy is his top played Caitlyn and Fiora and Kindred, so like, he could be any of the things.
Alright, boys, we in the champ select.
Alright, well, the Whitfield guy has a, I think he's their support. No, it's Ingard's their support.
We'll
Fiona
see.
Is the most played?
We're playing this on, what, 6.10? Yeah, 6.10.
Yeah,
so Swain's so still busted.
Yeah, but I don't think Doggo plays Swain, so more than likely you might see a Brand ban come in, and Sniper might get a Jinx ban.
I'd say Sniper will get a Jinx ban. After me watching any of the past games, it wouldn't surprise me to see a Jinx ban. It's his most played, and he really has the capacity to carry on it.
Can you see the ban, by the way? Or is that
I'm not showing for me yet, but I assume they have a ban. Yeah, there's a Zed ban. Get at the gates. Not
so,
entirely sure if that's targeted or not, because I haven't really looked at Narnia.
And
we're back to the lobby. Fantastic.
Well, the Bran guy is 0-3 on Zed in ranked play.
That should
but
be fine.
In fairness to him, he's had a 12-7 KDA. for as his average, so that's like
that's not abysmal. So.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's fine. Keeping it spicy. Let's see.
So we'll just get the DC sorted and get back into the game, I guess.
Oh, actually, Umbreon Reaper, the AD carry for Narnia, has his most played as Jinx. So,
oh, that's interesting.
They might actually first pick it away from Sniper.
They can't, though, because Praetorian are... well, yeah, actually, yeah, they can't.
Yeah, they might, because his win rates on the others aren't so good, but Jinx and Tristana seem to be his go-tos. Lucian isn't looking so hot, but he might have just gotten lucky in the games.
See, I don't think that's too detrimental, because I know Sniper can fall back onto something like Sivir or Jhin. He plays both of them.
Both
of them are still, like, Jhin, maybe not meta at the moment, but he's still incredibly strong in lane, and if he gets ahead...
I'm curious how Princely Prince will play this game, because in the game against... I can't remember the team name, but whoever Charx's team was... He played Ignite Zac, which was...
Yeah, Ignite Smite Zac.
Fairly suspect, seeing as he didn't actually use his Ignite much at all.
Yeah, it was pretty questionable.
Yeah, we'll find out how that goes, I suppose. I can't imagine there's too much action going to happen in the top lane. Just looking at their champ pools, I know Uncooking Rice seems to play, like, Go'Gath. You know, the big... one game I've seen, but he also... You see, I'm assuming he's going to be playing tanks, so it'll be sort of a wet noodle fight.
I think that's what it's going to be. Yeah. Like, they seem to be putting Unhooking Rice. I can't even pronounce his name properly. That's just terrible.
Oh, Unhooking.
Unhooking, I know, right?
Oh, okay.
They seem to be putting Unhooking Rice onto kind of comfort picks. He didn't seem particularly comfortable on Cho'Gath. Now, maybe that was just a... Oh, we'll just pick it because it's their sort of champion, I guess. But
his mechanics seemed okay. His CSing not so much. But
oh well.
Yeah, that's I guess.
That's I guess that's kind of expected, to be honest with you.
Rory the or Whittle, I think, is the mid laner. Doesn't seem to have any mid laners in his top 50 in most played champions.
Oh, that's fine. Honestly.
So I'm
okay,
curious.
We're back.
I guess he could whip out anything, really.
Sure. Why not?
Yeah. Actually, he has a 65% win rate on Malphite out of 43 games. So, maybe AP Malphite mid?
It's a possibility. It's actually not terrible at the moment. The new Hextech gun belt thingy, whatever it's called.
Yeah, I love the Hextech gun belt.
Yeah, it's pretty spicy on him, to be honest with you. Like, yeah, you can 100-0 basically anybody but a tank if you get ahead. Alright, let's look at the bans. Kindred Echo is pretty standard. I don't think Princely plays Kindred, though, so...
I don't think so either, but I think it's typical Praetorian, I want to say, bans to ban out the Assassins, because Doggo is probably the best player on the team, or Sniper.
Sniper and Doggo,
and
yeah.
Both their champion pools get wrecked by Assassins, so if they just take them out of the game... The AD carries freed up to pick hyper carries and the mid lane control mages.
Yeah, that's right. Like, Doggo doesn't play any of the kind of high intensity assassins like Zed and Fizz and things like that, so he'll stick back to Orianna, Brand, etc. Here's the first pick, Jinx.
Yeah,
that's a good call.
So, I guess we're expecting a Jhin pick, and there's Doggo.
There's
was
the Malphite.
A very enthusiastic person when it came to Bran before the rework, so his mechanics are pretty much the same, if not just better. So.
You'll notice his win rate's fairly low on it this time around, which is in part to some rough games in the early season, but
yeah.
He is exceptionally good at the champion. I can tell you that from experience, so we'll have to see how that goes.
LeBlanc's still up though, so maybe the... or Whittle.
I don't mean to sound cruel, but I think picking Twisted Fate is just very dangerous. If he gets behind, he's going to stay behind.
It is. Especially since Twisted Fate would lose lane very hard to Bran.
Yeah, exactly.
And if he TPs somewhere and gets behind, there's going to be no coming back. I think better pick would be like an Orianna or a Lulu to support the Jinx more, but...
Yeah, exactly.
Now, Whittle, assuming he's the mid laner, doesn't seem to have any games played on TF. But maybe on a Smurf he's played some, or in normals recently he's been playing them. So...
May just be a pick that he decided to try on the biggest stage of them all.
probably
not the best idea.
The game sound down.
My game sound?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'll turn it down now. I'd get into the lobby to do it, or the thing.
Oh, yeah.
I usually play music on, so I'll turn it on.
The saver was pretty obvious.
Okay, so let's look at the comps, because... pretty much Praetorian's gotten everything they wanted, bar the Jinx. Villain's on a support he's comfortable with. One thing about Villain is he can be a little hit and miss depending on the support he's on. He can be an absolutely monstrous Bard or Braum, but then there's other times where it kind of goes a little out of control. That's just how it goes.
Braum's a stage.
Yeah, exactly. Braum is
disengaged with W on Villain.
Yeah. He's an insanely good support, so it should be fine in that respect.
Sejuani picked up here, and Maokai. So you're right about the top lane, too. Unless horrible mistakes are made, nothing's gonna... Oh, and the Vi.
I'm not mad on the Vi pick into, the Sej, Maokai, yeah.
In fairness, their idea might be Sej and Maokai obviously aren't gonna be doing tons of damage. TF also, if he's behind, won't be doing much damage. So with the Sivir ult, the Malphite ult, and the Vi, they can just assassinate the Jinx, essentially.
That's true.
So maybe their goal is to just delete the Jinx out of the fight, and then, although even say full items late game, if the Jinx goes down, the TF isn't going to be able to kill the whole Praetorian team. So I actually really like Praetorian's comp here. Although, yeah, maybe something. Gragas, maybe?
I even feel a Zac would have been fine, honestly. Like, if you had just taken Smite Flash and played Zac, I think that would have been fine, honestly.
They might fear that having too much magic damage into two tanks would be a problem, and then leaving Sniper all on its own. But Sivir's late game damage is very high, so usually MR items aren't too good at the beginning of the game, so your AP can carry you through that, and then when they have their magic resist items all built, Sivir should have at least two items and start doing actual damage.
True, I just feel if Praetorian and Princely Prince decide to go a high damage buy, she's gonna get peeled really, really easily if she ever tries to hit their backline. Like, they've got Sejuani, they've got TF stun, they've got traps, they've got Alistair, and they've got Bind from Maokai. She's never going to get anybody to do any damage. So that rules out high AD. So if she goes tanky, I still don't feel she's going to do a whole lot.
Yeah. The only... Maybe what their plan, though, is instead of the Vi sort of going in and getting rooted, the Malphite, say, flash ults or get Sivir speed and ults, and then the Vi can follow up. But
of
it's
course,
still
yeah.
really dodge because... Maokai, Alistar, and Sejuani can all interrupt the Vi Q with their respective move speeds.
Definitely.
And even if the Vi jumps onto the Jinx, the Sejuani can just throw her ult at the backline of Praetorium and they can't move and do any damage. So it all depends on how coordinated Unhooking Rice and Princey Prince are and how fast Narnia's team can react to the engage.
That's completely true. One thing I will say about this is, with the Sivir engage, they have an enormous amount of move speed, like a move speed and pick potential on Praetorian side, against two very immobile backline. So, like what you were saying with the getting a decent Malphite engage and then comboing that with, say, Brand and Sivir damage, it's looking very likely it could happen. I just feel the Vi is just the odd one out, but that's my opinion.
Yeah, sure. Weirder things.
Have happened, that's true.
The one thing, though, seeing by team comp and champ select, I feel that Praetorian have just won fairly hard.
Handsomely won, yeah,
but
I would say so.
If they don't respect the TF and he gets rolling, they're going to lose very hard, very quickly. Because if Vi gets behind, she's quite useless. And if Sivir gets behind, she takes a long time to ramp up.
Yep.
So if either Jinx or TF, or TF can either snowball himself or Jinx, their lineup isn't going to be able to cope with the amount of damage coming out and all the CC from the three tanks of Narnia's team.
That's one thing I don't think we brought up. The fact that they got the Maokai pick on Narnia's side, that's so huge. Like, that champion is incredibly, incredibly powerful if he gets past the mid game. Like, he can lose lane 1-6, 1-7, but after that, there's pretty much no champion in the game who's going to beat him. Anyway, we're getting into the game now. Let me just adjust the sounds when we get in. I can turn my sound back up. Sorry about that, anybody watching, but
we're all 14 viewers, so
I am deaf person. Not really, but I do like my sound quite high, so that's probably why.
Do you play with I don't play with master volume at all. I don't think I listen to any in-game sound.
I listen to music and stuff. It just throws me if I don't. Yeah. Okay, getting into the game now. Let me just sort out the stream.
Any nice skins? That's the real.
That's the real game here. If there's good skins, whoever's the best skins win.
I'm trying to think what Malphite skin's the nicest.
Okay, let's see.
Oh, well, they got the demon combo with the demon Vi and spirit fire brand, and then they got McCree.
They do have McCree Twisted Faith. Yeah,
that's my favorite skin.
And, shout out to anybody who bought Overwatch in the last week and has had no life since then. I know
Flashbang.
I have.
His flashbang's basically yellow card.
So it's gonna miss about 2/3 of the time.
Now the real question is Bran Reginald, and how many blue cards will he be able to land?
That is really important, actually, to know. Well, they have Mastery 6. Is it Mastery 6?
Yeah, I was about to say, worth mentioning. Now, although he has no ranked games on... Oh, wait, I think we got slightly savaged when I asked were they in order, and they said yes, and they just weren't. So... I'll go check really quick now on his...
Basically, what we can take from this is Bran is actually a Twisted Fate main and fantastic at the champion.
But he has a 50% win rate out of 16 games in ranked, but clearly having the Master Level 6 means he's gotten an S minus or higher in his last couple of TF games. And same with Umbreon Reaper. So, high hopes, I suppose, if... Say he's just been on a hot streak recently with the champ. He's clearly doing quite well with it.
Music, but not in the game. Are you in game yet?
I'm getting the music, I'm not in the game yet.
Alright. There we go, boys. We're in.
I wonder if there'll be any cheesy level 1. Because Velen on the Braum has the passive, but Maokai, Sedge, and Alistar could all steal their respective CCs. And, go ham, let's go.
Let me just change my sound, master volume. Okay, we're good. We are good. Direct account. Alright, so it looks like they're just setting up for a line of scrimmage. That's pretty standard for any sort of competitive team these days. They just got the river ward, it's fine. It doesn't look like they're going in for any lane swap wards or any of that shenanigans.
If Narnia were crafty, they could actually sneak through the mid lane where Doggo isn't actually protecting. But
that is true.
It doesn't really matter because
one adaptation that I'm seeing from a lot of not higher end teams, but kind of Division 1 teams, they're putting the jungler in mid, and then they're putting the mid laner off to the side, so it's not telegraphing which side the jungler is starting on. But that doesn't seem to be the case for either team at the moment.
Out of curiosity, are you just on direct camera, yeah?
Just direct camera.
Well, we'll just follow that. So it's on Malphite right now, yeah?
Yeah.
And now it's on, say, Jellystone.
Yep.
Yeah, okay.
Maybe see a play anywhere else, just shout and link it to camera. Right. But I couldn't be bothered.
Funny enough, everyone has biscuits on Praetorian side except the jungler. And it's nearly mirrored on the other side. The biscuits is probably the best mastery in that tree. You could consider taking it on the blue buff duration on Bran, but I'd agree overall that the biscuits are just the way to go.
One interesting tidbit about the blue buff duration is it actually works for buffs like Herald now. So it will extend the duration of Herald.
The 20 minute.
Yeah, exactly. Now, it's not too important for a mid laner. They don't tend to get Herald buff often, but if top laners ever went down that tree, it is a viable option nowadays.
It could be possible the Maokai is actually...
Some level 1 aggression from villain. Gets the passive up, but no pushing forward from my cool sniper. Just gonna farm it out.
Well, and the brand
bullying the TF a little.
This is what we expected, honestly.
Yeah, the TF can do damage early, but against an Ignite brand, he's just never going to be able to win out in terms of damage.
So essentially at the moment, I feel that barring top lane, Praetorian have winning lanes all over the map early game. Like, Alistair is not going to be able to do a whole lot early with the spell shield and the wall from... Braum blocking all of the damage coming from Jinx, so I feel that Praetorian can put a lot of pressure on the spot lane, just jam it under tower and then test. Oh, there's a disconnect, so we're looking for a pause.
Should probably come in.
There we go.
A little late.
Gives us a minute to talk about what's going on at the moment anyway.
Yeah, true.
So both junglers started on bot side of the jungle, it seems. So that leaves their top exposed. It is red Drake for the dice roll Drake today, which is the second best, I'd say.
It could potentially be the best for Praetorium's team, because regen doesn't matter too much to them, because they're not going to be sticking around and poking out.
That's
they want to full out engage, so the more damage, the merrier, I suppose. Gank on Doggo.
That's a very early gank.
Not very well coordinated by Narnia. And... Well, they win the trade in terms of...
Summoners, yeah.
Brand doesn't have Ignite anymore, so TF can actually pressure a little bit, and Sedge shouldn't be too strained in the jungle, like half HP is fine to make her clear.
Her clear is relatively fine. I think that was a really, really early Ignite from Doggo, though.
Yeah.
I don't feel he needed to use it that early.
He may have felt that the Princey Prince would have got the third proc on...
Wise E passive.
Yeah, and then
W passive.
It would have probably chunked a good bit because Sedge has a lot of health.
Sure.
But it didn't happen.
There's a scrap going on in mid.
Oh, he's oomed though. The TF notices this and is going aggressive. So yellow card in the mid. And it's a reasonably passive game at the moment. Oh, as I say that.
It's a good spell shield. See.
What can they do to trade into the.
Exactly.
Probably the safest bot lane you can pick, other than, say, Ezreal, Janna, perhaps.
I feel that now that it's level 4, level 5, unhooking Ryze is just going to get bullied around this top lane by this Maokai. He got a bit of a CS lead, but he's out of pots now, and it's pushing him under his tower. I don't know how he's going to sustain the damage, because Maokai's damage from 5 upwards is deceptively high. Like, he will smash you to bits.
I'd say his best bet is to... He's on 900 gold now. As soon as he can buy a Spectre's Cowl, he should back, buy it, and TP in.
Definitely.
And then at least he gets, say, a wave or two of shoving, because the Maokai will have to react to the TP in back. But they may be wanting to keep their TP to counter, say, TF's TP in the bot lane. But at this point, Maokai or Malphite has no mana for ult, even if he was level 6.
Some nice damage going out of mid there. A little scrap between the two mid laners, but nothing coming of it. Yeah, I agree. I feel Spectre's Cowl is the best buy he can get at the moment. I really dislike the fact that he didn't start with Corrupting Potion, because I feel he has to back with an extra 100 gold just to pick up pots, or he's never going to be able to sustain against this Maokai.
Even with the Cowl, it doesn't actually give...
Exactly.
...like, millions of regen. It's just a counteract poke, not actual trading. So, yeah, I also... It's not like the Doran's Shield is blocking Maokai's insane attack speed or anything like
that. Most of his harass comes from his Q anyway, so...
Or the magic damage on the passive where he gets the health back.
Yeah, definitely.
None of it's... and grass. It's annoying we can't see Mastery Keystones
they
have.
I
assume Maokai has...
Grass.
But since the Malphite has Biscuits, I might kind of think he may have taken Thunderlords, perhaps.
Oh, engage in bot lane?
Very good. Oh, and the Flash Force from Sivirus. Fairly.
That was a really, really nice engage.
I think the Jinx W actually broke the shield. I'll go back and check that. So, as the Headbutt Pulled went in, the Jinx W hit to delete the shield.
Yep.
I'll just go check that now.
I see Praetorian are setting up early vision control around that dragon, maybe looking for an early dragon. Sejuani's sitting bot side, might be looking for an early enough gank. She should have just hit level 5 if she has. Nope, just going to go continue clearing. Yeah, it's been a very passive game from the junglers, barring the first engage in mid lane around level 3. Really hasn't been a whole lot of kind of activity. I feel as soon as I hit 6, though, when Sejuani and Vi get their pretty heavy engage ults, we should see much more explosive plays.
Interestingly enough, though, Narnia are about 500 gold behind. Obviously not like a huge amount in terms of the scheme of things, but it is interesting that they're slowly losing gold when there's been no towers taken. It's just pure farm that they're dropping behind gold. And if, say, as we know from the other games Praetorium have played, they do lane phase for quite a while.
That's true.
And if at 7 minutes they're 500 gold ahead, that might become grow in size and become, say, 1,000 or 2,000 gold if the laning phase goes to like 30 minutes as it did in the other game.
One thing I will say is you're definitely seeing the kind of rank disparity. I know we don't really go by rank in solo queue, but My Cool Sniper is the highest ranked player in the tournament, or the second highest, I'm not sure. Which is definitely showing in his CS numbers. Like, he is 13 CS up. He's last hitting much more effectively than the Jinx, even though the lane hasn't really been pushed to either side or the other.
Yeah, but in fairness to the Jinx, though, she's like holding out fairly well.
Yeah, she's sitting at about 10 CS deficit, which isn't terrible, but actually a large CS deficit has formed in mid lane.
Yeah,
the 13 CS lead.
Well, just picking up some of the towers, so it's not all going to waste, yeah. But yeah. Oh, or well, she's leaving a couple of... Well, and even after that, Sedge is still behind the jungle, so... Both team... I think the team comps, though, feel a bit kind of odd in terms they both want a team fight, but... they both have good team fighting, but they need to... Narnia need to get picks first. Or at least a TF engage. You know, I don't really know what I'm talking about here.
I understand what you're saying. Like, you're basically saying that Narnia would prefer to be taking 2 or 3 man skirmishes with their abilities at the moment, yeah, rather than team fights, because I feel that Malphite and Doggo and Sniper will just shred. That is a massive amount of damage from the Brand in mid.
The TF not building Abyssal first may get heavily punished for it. If a Brand W does nearly half his HP, if a flash ult from Princely Prince will just kill him instantly.
Go ahead, sorry.
Oh yeah, no, go for it.
But bear in mind, that's a Brand with only 2 Doran's Rings and the new item, the Lost Chapter. Oh, and an engage him in, that's Force of Flash.
I think... if Princely Prince had just Q flashed, and then Doggo had chained his flash, which he did, but he was a little late on it, if they had coordinated that better, they could have killed TF in a stun lock. So they wouldn't have just lost the dragon for free, they would have at least gotten a mid kill.
Yeah, definitely.
But then again, this is Division 3, so they're still learning, and might be something for the future.
Might not be as experienced as some of the kind of... higher division teams,
higher, yeah,
I'd say.
Yeah.
One thing I did notice, though, is Narnia have traded for the Drake in the meantime, and that is the Fire Drake, so that is the 8%, I believe, AD and AP, which is...
I feel it's not so relevant for them to have it, more that the other...
To keep it away from Praetorian.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But then again, it's never not good to have that much free
damage. Yeah, free damage is free damage.
Probably worth a lot. I wonder if they still would have made that move if it was, say, an Earth Dragon. Or would they have tried to, say, pressure bot? Oh, something's going on the bot lane.
Sejuani's coming around for his gank. Oh, villain's caught out.
Really good head for pulverize. And no, he's
nothing
just walked
comes
out. Sej had ult there.
Sej did have ult. I don't know if they would have the damage to burst down villain because he still had his jump.
I feel they would have been able to at least force a flash, which would have taken pressure off.
Oh, this is very
and now,
risky.
I don't think they could take this.
No, Princely Prince is going to go down from this if he's not careful.
That was a good flash. Oh, the TF ult. Oh, that was really, really well played by Bran. And now, unhooking right, he has flash, but nowhere to go. Oh, Doggo
coming in with the big damage. gets a passive up on
the hero scored.
No!
That was very unfortunate. Oh, the...
Pick up a kill.
Oh, but... and bot lane action everywhere. Alright, well,
Let's calm it down a little bit, yeah. And review what happened.
Will we rewind and watch the fight in bot lane? Because, let's be real, nothing's going to happen in the next...
Sure, let's rewind for a second and have a look.
It looks like... Paradigm engaged on Narnia. I think I'm just...
Yeah, Sniper and Villain have pushed in, gotten the passive up on Jinx, and then Witzel has engaged on Villain. The Braum, and a lovely ult from Villain.
Oh, and that was a really good exhaust as well. So, in the end, they just traded summoners. Jinx not having any summoners might require a gank from Princely Prince with ult to just kill him instantly.
Yeah, I feel the fact that Princely Prince has his ult up, they can literally just dive that now with the Braum and destroy her. She should go bot lane right now and just dive.
Speaking of the Rift Herald, though, it was a really good intuition from Rory to actually just be like, oh, well, they could be on this, go down, and then just knowing his TF can follow up to flash straight onto Princely Prince. That was just really well played.
And it shows how ballsy you can play on a Maokai. Like, he hit, level 7, level 8 at the time? All he has to do is pop his ultimate and just go straight on that Vi. That Vi is on pure damage at the moment. She has no defensive stats. She's just gone absolutely shredded.
And I think it's a mistake for Princely Prince to get the damage item. Even, I think he actually should have considered the... new sort of devour type item that does percentage health, because Vi with attack speed against tanks is really strong because her W can proc a couple of times, and then obviously the item does percentage max health, so she'd actually be able to shred the tanks. So instead of just having to go for the Jinx, if the Brand builds a Liandry's, they could just shred the front line really quickly and then just deal with the backline after. Not as ideal as just killing the backline, but if it came to it, it would be a more diverse build.
Yeah, that's definitely reasonable. So let's look how we are at the moment. One thing I will say about bot lane is my cool sniper is still up on CS, and he did get a first back call, I want to say. First back. Which is now stacking up.
Quite late, though.
It is. Yep.
He bought it with his VT and Zeal.
Seriously? Okay. Well, that's...
I'll go back and check.
That's a little suspect, if true, but...
Yeah, no. He bought it with his VT, and then he bought the Zeal a little later.
It looks like they're going to be under minimal pressure, and I guess if he did have that extra gold lying around, it's not a terrible buy. But I feel something like a longsword should be used later on might have been just better to win out the lane.
Then again, if they are planning on going late into the laning phase, like, they've made no effort to take a tower yet, and they've given up well.
Oh, Villain's in a really bad spot at the moment. Sorry to cut across you. The Sejuani is coming across, has ultimate up. Is she going to unleash it? No. She's very, very kind of... pentient, I guess you could say, with those ultimates. That's two opportunities now, and another good engage onto my cool sniper. Gets a really, really good spell shield out, and nothing comes of it again. Okay, where was I? The Sejuani seems to be very kind of passive with those ultimates. That's twice now that she could have thrown at least one or two hits.
She hasn't even thrown it, so it could have been off cooldown by the time. Like,
exactly, yeah.
You miss every spear you don't throw, as Hacho GG would say, so...
The one true god.
Yeah, him not ulting is actually fucking him over a little bit in terms of he's not forcing any flashes, so then when he does ult, they'll just flash.
Again? I really feel they could have just picked up Braum there, honestly.
Mm-hmm. What time are you up, by the way? I think my spectators.
15:15?
15:15?
Yeah.
15:20. Oh, I'm 15:40. Oh, what?
Oh, I'm still behind.
Oh, just drag it, straight up?
Yeah, that's what I did. Oh, I jumped alive. Okay, yeah, no, it's fine.
15:54.
That's the second time I've done that. Okay, yeah, we're back at live. Don't worry, guys. We're all good. Okay, where were we?
Grab it. And basically, just nothing's happening at the moment. Except in mid lane, where a gank unsuccessful. Honestly, I have no idea how they're not killing this TF. He only has flash, and they have three pieces of CC between them, both with flash up, and they have ignite on their side.
It's definitely frustrating me, because I keep seeing the Vi gank, not unleashing her ult, which again won't be stopped by the gold card even if it's in flight. And then as soon as that ult hits, you can have Doggo combo him with the stun, ignite, burn. There's no way he'll survive.
I think both Doggo and Christy Prince are too... They're not... They could say either of them could flash and use their stun. So Doggo could use his Q, and Christy Prince could also use their Q. And then they follow up with, say, their ult. Instead, what seems to be happening is Princey Prince is, like, running in to get the ult, giving TF time. Then, when his ult's out of range, he decides to attempt the Q, which just isn't working.
And I really feel that they have to get this TF shut down, because obviously the guy is quite experienced at TF. He's 2-0-1 at the moment. He's looking to build into his Lich Bane, and it looks like probably Proto Belt or Gunblade. Not really sure which one at the moment.
I think I know Voiboy probably builds Gunblade on TF, so...
It seems to be quite effective. And if they put pressure in mid lane, then it keeps pressure off of the side lanes, which I feel, with Sivir and Braum kind of not taking advantage of the damage they can put out and the push potential they have early, is pretty detrimental.
It is, yeah, it is interesting. We will... I'll see... Oh, no, nothing.
I think it's just the playstyle of... I can't even remember their name. Praetorian? To just lane phase forever.
That is true.
They don't seem to want to make any plays except the occasional gank. But they just sort of sit there with their flashes and then flash away from ganks. But I feel they need to pull a trigger at some stage, because the Jinx will get to the point where the Malphite and the Vi won't be able to kill her if she has, say, a Banshee's Veil.
Oh, definitely.
With everything surrounding her.
Oh, we're getting an engage here?
There's the trigger.
That was a really, really... That was a fantastic engage. Well played. That exhaust came out a really good time. And it looks like Vitzel's going to go down now. That should be bot tower now as well,
and
as they continue to push.
Drake has just respawned. So
and that is the Water Drake, which is the best Drake for laning phase. And we all know in kind of lower ranked games, the laning phase tends to be extended longer. So that's a huge boon if they can pick both of them up.
And that's exactly what they're doing. Except, Miko Sniper can just solo the tower, I suppose.
Oh, it looks like TF...
Now, Sejuani and TF sort of wasted time. They potentially could have went top and just dove the Malphite.
Yeah, I agree. That's
a good trade, but didn't happen. Guess that's okay. Back to farming.
One thing I am noticing in this top lane is Rory the Fish is using a lot of his mana just to farm, whereas I feel he can just win trades with Malphite now. Like, he's picked up his Rod of Ages. Malphite's only sitting on a Cowl and a Kindle Gem. It's not a whole lot. And I think Malphite's just an inherently weaker champion than Rory. I think if Rory just lets Malphite push, engages onto him, takes him out of lane, he can just win that lane straight up. But at the moment, he's just using a lot of his mana to farm.
I also, now, if I'm correct in his itemization, he seems to be going Spirit Visage first, which is just not great. Usually,
yeah,
you just pick up the Cowl, and then you either build into Sun or Bami Cinder or Abyssal.
Yeah.
Abyssal wouldn't be too bad, because they have sort of three AP-ish champions, if you count Sejuani as an AP.
Well, you gotta counter something.
true. But yeah, he's finished the Visage. Most of the cost for that item comes with the 25% extra healing.
Yeah.
And he has no healing at all in his kit. So even if he had a corrupting potion, at least he'd get slightly extra value off that.
Definitely.
But he didn't even have that, so very suspect item choice.
This is a really nice invade, taking the red buff away from the... Oh no, it's not an invade, sorry, my bad. Jeez.
It is in fact their own jungle.
This is a nice gank mid, though.
It did look like they were grouping two invades, so they took action and got the buff for their jungle, which is pretty important.
So they've rotated three or four to mid, trying to pressure this mid tower. Obviously, the bot tower is down, this is the right play. Just stack in mid, play ARAM for about 10 minutes.
Now, I think if the Jinx is there, Narnia could actually win that fight. And still the Sejuani doesn't throw at her ult.
Oh, that fantastic damage from Dogo.
Killing both. Now, if the Sejuani had just thrown her ult about 10 seconds earlier, they could have disengaged. But instead she waits till she dies from the brand damage. And then, well, just dies and gets...
Yeah, I just can't agree with that. Like,
that's
we,
the first ult she's thrown this game? Is that correct?
That we've seen. At the moment, Praetorian is just getting a massive amount of pressure in mid lane. Like, Jinx got bot tower, but that doesn't mean anything when you're losing your entire mid lane.
The Alistar is also going to die here. Very late ultimate, but... potentially... See, if the Jinx was in that fight, and say the Sedge had actually thrown her ult earlier, Alistar also had ult. This fight would have
Would have been way different.
Yeah, I'd say a high chance that if Umbreon Reaper had gotten some lucky Infinity Edge crits with his rockets, probably would have just sealed the fight, but it's not how it played out, and now they are 2k behind, roughly.
One thing we got to look at now is Doggo has picked up his Morellos, but he's also more than halfway to his Rylai's, and we all know what happens when Brian gets Rylai's. Like, he will put out an enormous amount of damage, especially with a Malphite ult. So they really, really need to be careful and really look at kind of not grouping too hard and kind of trying to get picks, two or three man skirmishes at this rate.
Sivir's also at two item, well, not including boots, but like two item power spike, where she'll actually do damage now, not just sort of
throw fish at people.
But yeah. Whereas Jinx is just around IEZL, which still has potential to do a lot of damage, but nowhere near as much as the Sivir.
One thing I want to point out while we've got a little bit of a lull in the action, that one of my pet peeves, I see the side of Narnia have only picked up one blue trinket and one sweeper at the moment, or sticking with three warding trinkets. I think they honestly need another blue trinket just to try and maintain vision in the jungle or in the river and in the opposite side, because if they're face checking to drop those yellow wards, they're just gonna die. So when it comes to objective control, they're in big trouble. And this is a pretty big teleport. That's a huge ultimate from the Sejuani, but unfortunately for her,
this is probably game over here.
There was not enough of a group, and it was 3v4. That was a good teleport in, and yeah, that's basically just a wipe in mid lane, and the Drake is spawning in the next minute or so. So
I think
they're in trouble.
I'm not sure. First of all, they need to actually group as five. But even at that, even if they get a pick on Doggo, if Doggo just gets his abilities off, he's gonna kill TF or Jinx. And Baron's being picked up here, probably rotate to the dragon after, and I'd say that should seal the game for Narnia. Well, seal the game out of Narnia's hands.
And that Baron is fairly safe, because we all know how much damage a Brand and a Sivir can put out early.
Now, Maokai knows he's a little screwed here.
He is going to Dreamland.
He goes for the heroic attempt. Doggo picks up another kill. They're at 6-1. And he'll finish Rylai's. Now, they seem to be doing a 3-man push on the tower and letting two people back.
Sacrifice Drake for it, which is probably the right call. It is only the Earth Drake, and I really, really feel like Narnia are never going to get near a Baron at this rate with how far they are behind. Like, they're 6k behind. Baron's just been taken. I think it's fine to give it up and take it to tower instead.
I'd say the next fight will also be the last fight of the game, unless Narnia can pull some incredible team fighting out and win the fight, but by the looks of it,
this is very risky from Praetorian. I don't think they really need to be going into three or four men at once as two men. They just need to group five, play a team fight, win the game.
Narnia had no vision, so maybe they had the sort of element of...
That is true. And they have pushed them off, so...
That plus the Baron, powers are going to drop incredibly quickly, as well as Sivir's auto-attack reset.
I feel the shock calling on Narnia's side is just a bit all over the place at the moment. As soon as they saw three men top, they just had to rush that Drake and just get it quickly. By being pushed off, they've lost top tower, they've lost momentum in mid, and they've lost that Drake as well. They can send my cool sniper to bot lane just to push in the wave. They have Baron buff on everybody. It's just not looking good.
But that seems to be the story of the game, where Narnia were just picking, or not even picking, but getting caught with, say, two or three people to the four or five of their opponents.
Definitely, no.
Yeah, there was...
Oh, but there... Even there, if Jinx had been... If the Maokai had communicated with the Jinx...
This is not an engaged Princely Prince once, but... Oh, Malphite and Doggo!
With the flank.
The hero damage.
Getting the passive up on most. A late exhaust from Azure probably not going to save him.
Incredibly late.
TF doing damage, but I don't think it might be enough.
This is the power of the Maokai, though. Unless he's shut down, he can just walk up and pummel your team.
And this might be the team fight they were looking for. Michael Sniper staying in the bot lane, and TF damage really stepping it up there. But a little too late. Although he has 4 kills and he's getting items, he needed to... He didn't use his ult once to gank bot lane or top. There was plenty of opportunities for it. If he comboed it with the Sejuani, they were guaranteed a kill almost on anybody.
And I feel like a lot of that's down to just the pressure that Doggo was able to put on. He was constantly pushing him under tower the entire game, and unless you're confident enough to be able to CS push out and teleport to a side lane and get back in time, you're either going to fall really far behind, or you're never going to be able to pressure a side lane, and that just seems to be what happened.
I feel like it might have been worth just giving up a wave and just making the TP play anyway.
Oh, definitely, I agree.
It fell apart regardless, so even at least if he tried to make a play, he could have, say, gotten bot tower, maybe got another Drake under their belt.
Yeah.
And they had plenty of CC in the bot lane. Even the AD carry unusually had a snare, so... Would have been perfect opportunity on the immobile sniper, or even for Om when he had no flash. But back to the push mid. Who knows? Maybe Narnia can pull out a team fight, catch Doggo before he can throw out his abilities.
Oh, Maokai is so far pushed.
He may be able to teleport out, but it looks like he's running into the enemy team.
Princely Prince would be able to interrupt it anyway. I think he's just going to Dreamland at the moment. He is done.
And that's probably going to steal the game. They needed him to at least absorb a couple of damage, or a couple of abilities.
At this rate, there's basically nothing defensive on either Jinx or TF, and the huge front line is dead at the moment. I feel like it just tower dive the Jinx and TF if needed, and just drop an ult from Doggo in there.
The Brandle would probably kill them.
Exactly.
At this rate. Yeah. Oh, look, the damage from a Ricochet and a Braum Q nearly killing Jinx pretty much.
They are just, they're not pushing the wave in though. This is frustrating to watch. The top wave sat there, blue wave sat there for a while and just wasn't pushed in. That was a wasted ult from Villain as well.
I feel the Malphite could have just ulted in there and killed the TF, but...
I think they just need to temper themselves, use the wave, and then dive under tower if they're going for it. But at this rate, Maokai's already back up. He can just TP onto that tower and engage.
Yeah, that was an incredible Q by Doggo. Jinx has to play much further back than she'd like to. Really, really well played by the Alistar, but...
Oh, the ultimate's going through from Doggo, though, and he shreds them to bits!
Narnia made some nice plays, but a little too late. Triple kill being picked up. Oh, quadra kill. Quadra kill being picked up by Michael. And yeah,
that must be the game.
I'm not sure why they're still pushing that tower when they could just go to mid and take the inhib, but maybe they want both.
Yeah, timers are not long enough for him to push in top, though. That's the problem, so they need to just take inhibitor and get back.
Oh, but instead they're splitting and sending their AD carry. Now, they do have the Earth Dragon. But Malphite is not hitting the tower and getting the true damage. They may just end up with one inhib here, or no inhibs and just two towers.
This is... Oh, the Malphite might die. They do not have creep!
Oh no! This is
a Dignitas moment, friends! Doggo gets it.
But the GA on Sejuani, and he picked up the shutdown, I want to say? No, it's shutdown, actually, that was...
That's huge!
Really, very important, getting the shutdown across the board.
Not only that puts Doggo at a 40-second death timer. Drake is up in 50 seconds, and Baron is up in 40 seconds, so that's actually massive. There's no TP from Doggo either. I think that's just a shot-calling issue, honestly. I think they just need to take one tower, try and focus the inhib. Sejuani can't do anything solo to them, and then just get out of there and back and get the objectives.
Even if Sivir had just hit the top tower, then they all rotated to mid and taken the top. They would have been able to guarantee what they have now, but just without losing two people.
Of course, yeah, definitely. It's questionable. It gives them a lot of pressure in mid now. And they can set up to look for the Drake. That's Narnia Gaming.
Now, even with that mistake, I think the goal lead is quite far behind, but the gold is also on all the right people.
Of course.
So Brand and Sivir have all the gold. Now TF is horribly out of position here. Could he turn on the Sivir? Yeah. Oh no, that's unfortunate by Witzel. But he's running. He's running. Maokai getting ready to go in.
On the
Maokai, not exactly the target he wants. Good disengage by Narnia, anyway. And they are retreating.
That gives up the Drake if they decide to go for it, though. I don't think Bran... Well, Bran has teleport, so... they could look for that. That is one thing I will say about this comp as well on Narnia's side, is they did have the two teleport threats, and if they did get ahead, it would have been very dangerous going for a 1-3-1. Or Praetorian defending a 1-3-1, should I say. Alas, that did not happen.
I think... Bran and Syndergaard were far too hesitant with their ults, and they just didn't make any opportunities when their comp kind of demands it. Because if you don't use your ult, you only have three abilities, which is... Like, I can see where they're coming from, where they want to hold it for the perfect opportunity, but it just didn't present itself, obviously, enough, so sometimes you have to settle for less ideal circumstances.
And honestly, even in the early game, trading an ult for a flash is pretty good. Especially for a jungler. Like, you can put so much pressure on a lane if they don't have flash. You can just sit there camping, they can't get farmed, they can't do anything.
But Malphite taking them? Oh, he already has a blade. And so the game continues.
And a very early flash out of Maokai, I guess just not risking his life. But he is the tankiest member on the team.
Simply Prince getting good. Sivir ulted to safety. Probably unnecessary, I don't think they were going to chase it out.
There is a big wave stacking in bot lane that someone's going to have to deal with. It's going to crash into that tower, but looks like they're going to pressure this inhibitor.
I think Narnia need to pull the trigger now if they're going to pull it. Oh, that was a fantastic Sejuani ult, but Bran is going down. Witzel's also fallen. Reaper probably is going to die to the burn. Yeah, and the Sivir ricochet, really well positioned by Michael. That should be it.
At that rate, it didn't matter how tanky the Maokai was. If he couldn't peel for the Jinx, it was game over. And that's game one taken. Oh, there's only one game in D3?
I want to say yes.
I want to say yes as well, because there's 8 teams, I believe. So that should be the game. So that's a win for Praetorian.
Not too bad. Now, although they were 15k ahead in the end, there was some suspect moments, and I think they need to sort out their lack of plays in the early game, because if a team can just punish them for their farm playstyle, they're going to get very punished. Like,
and we saw that in the game against Charx's team that I can't remember, is they just got dragged around the map, missed ultimates, missed opportunities, and they just got shredded.
Yeah, I think, and also they're not even picking the best scaling comps. If another team would just pick scaling champions against them, I feel they wouldn't get punished at all.
Definitely, definitely. Well, that concludes the Division 3 Narnia and Praetorian game. So that puts Praetorian at 2-1, I want to say. 3-1? Not sure. And they're looking pretty good for LAN at the moment.
I'd say they'll make it now.
I feel from the games I've seen, they're probably the second best team in the tournament. So I'm looking forward to G-Series and seeing them at LAN. But I think that's going to do it for us, unless there is another game I can check, but I'm pretty sure it's best of one.
I'm pretty sure it's best of one, too.
Yep, best of one. Okay, guys, thanks for watching.
GG, well played.
Yes, good luck.